0.01, and by the way, it's f is non-negative, then we have the following moment inequality. Let me put it this way. Was like this. Right? Yes. And we used some kind of tricky Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, and we multiply them and all and so on. But this, so this is the problem that it's already solved. After we had two solutions, I told you how to proceed on the second solution. Now, a very similar problem. So today I want to do some, how to explore some ideas from the solutions from some problems in order to solve some other problems. Some similar problem, okay, maybe I should say more precisely similar ideas. So similar problem, this was actually from the American Mathematical Monthly, 2015, which says something a little bit like this. So if I have, so let f, so it's be a continuous function. Then show that we have the following inequality. The integral from 0 to 1 of f cubed of x dx is greater or equal than 4 times the integral of x squared f of x dx times the integral 0 to 1 of x f squared of x dx. Actually, if I look even closely, this is also related to another problem that we did, related to that Putnam B5 problem from 2006, I think it was, which was something to determine the max as x is in 0, 1 of IF minus JF. So that was the where IF is this guy and JF was this guy. And we also we gave two solutions for this problem. The second solution was the official solution, which was a little bit trickier. So, I wanted to show how we can use ideas from this problem and this problem to solve this problem.
So this is the only, I feel bad just like getting up and leaving in order to do that, so I just sit there.
Okay, let's see. So, actually, I'm going to show two solutions for this. Let's see. Let's rewrite a bit. So, our inequality is actually equivalent to this f cubed of x dx. Times this is f, this is 1 over 4, which is the integral of x cubed dx greater or equal than be our test. You have a headache?
No, because something.
I hope not because of this, right?
Yeah, it is.
Really? This give this.
No, no, just kidding.
This actually looks really nice. I'm not sure how this can give you a headache. Anyway. So we should remember how we did this problem with the second solution when we did the Cauchy work. So let me go back to the idea of this second solution. So we did something like we had a x cubed here. How can I write the integral of x cubed as a square?
X root x squared through.
So x root x squared, right? So I have times this, so I need here another integral of something which will be greater or equal than something squared. Well, that is the idea. And now let's look. What should I put there? So if I look at the problem, I need something one of these guys, I of f or g of f here squared. Because I want to write again another similar inequality so that when I multiply them, they will cancel somehow. That's the trick. So, what should I do? I have to put something here squared. Well, I have two possibilities, right? If I put my square root of f of x, and let's say times an x, it won't, so I'll have an x, and I'll have an x squared, I'll have a root x, it's not good, right?
Mm-hmm.
What I get here. So maybe I should reverse it a little bit. Let me put a square root of x times f of x. Is it good? So here it's x times f squared, this guy is x times f squared of x. This guy is what I need, and by Cauchy Schwarz here, what do we get? So we have the integral from 0 to 1 of x squared f of x. Dx. Okay. So I have this. You know this by, this is 1. So this integral, so that was the idea. And this actually, this is x cubed. So, what do I have? The integral of x f squared times x, the integral of x cubed, is greater or equal than this. But I want to obtain this. So I have one part here, but I have it squared, as you can recognize it here. So I should have here what? One of these guys. So I'm going to put here the integral of x squared f of x, right, which can be written as x root f of x squared dx. So I already have a square of my integral. Here I should get greater or equal than the integral from 0 to 1. And what should I get? I should get this guy, x f squared of x dx squared. And now it's kind of obvious what I should put here. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Should be what?
F cubed.
So I should put f of x root f of x squared dx, which is nothing else than f cubed of x. Well, let's call this inequality. This is 2. Now I multiply them, and I'll get exactly this guy here. You see the trick? Do you see the similarity between this and the idea of this? It was exactly the same idea. And also, what did I do? When I proved this, when I solved this, when I used to find the maximum, I used this part. Because from 1, you get the information about I of f and j of f. What do you get? You know that j of f times 1 over 4 is greater or equal than I of f squared. That was the information when we used to solve this to find the maximum. So 2 problems where you can use the ideas to solve this other problem. So they're very, very similar. In fact, I want to show you, this is tricky, but it's more with using Cauchy Schwarz, but you can use even Holder. So let me show you the second solution. Let's keep in mind that we need to prove star. That's our goal. So, second solution. So, I'm going to use the following Holder's inequality. Version of Holder's inequality. So this will be the integral from 0 to 1 of a of x, I'm going to change it into notation, times b of x dx, right? Well, the absolute is less than the 3 over 2 norm times of A times the 3 norm of B. You would not expect this. Well, what does it say, Holder? That usually says that A, B, the 1 norm is less than the B norm of A times the norm of B, right? Where these P and Q are positive such that 1 over P plus 1 over Q is 1. In our case, P is what?
3/2.
P is 3/2 and Q is?
3.
Right? Because 1 over plus 1 over 3 is actually 1, surprisingly. So this is very, very tricky. So let's keep this idea there. So let's use Holder's in this form. So I'm going to take so I'm gonna do basically something similar to previous solution. So I'm gonna take one of these guys, I'm gonna multiply with something, and it will be less or equal than something. I'm gonna take this guy, multiply with something, which will be less than something, but these guys will cancel, just like in the previous solution. So it goes a little bit like this. So we're gonna have the following. The integral from 0 to 1 of x squared of times f of x dx. So this will be less or equal than the integral from 0 to 1 of x squared to the power 3 over 2 dx to the power 2 over 3, right? Times the integral from 0 to 1 of f cubed of x dx, everything to what power? 1 over 3. This would be my inequality 1. Actually, let's identify here. This guy will be equal to x cubed, right? Right? And this guy is... And now, let's see inequality 2. So I need to do something similar, but for this guy. So I'll have the integral from 0 to 1 of x f squared of x dx is less or equal, and now let's see. I'll have two integrals here. So this time I will do the same thing, but instead of x, I'll put f of x. So I'll do f squared of x, everything to the power 3 halves, to the power 2 thirds. Does it make sense what I'm doing? And now, I'm going to do the same thing with this guy. So x cubed dx to 1 third. This guy is f cubed of x. Now, if we multiply these two, what do we get? So multiplying one and two, what are we going to get? Of course, the
please, a little break.
So, man, you really scared me. Anyway, so like I was saying,
anyway, the show must go on.
So, if we multiply these two, what are we going to get? Can you tell me? Do we get star? Do we? Yes, indeed, we do get stuck. Anyway, it's not the... You see? You have here... Look, if you multiply this with this, this is the same function, and this with this. They're the same. So we're going to get exactly what we want, because we have 1 third plus 2 thirds is 1.
Yeah. Now I do agree.
Anyway, that's it.
Yeah.
This whole thing is quite tricky. We should think of it. Usually, okay, let me point out a remark here, very important. Look, how you think of holder? Remember, when you have this exponents P and Q to be 1/2, both equal to 1/2, 1/2, it's Cauchy-Schwarz, actually, right? So, 1/2, 1/2. Equals 1. So basically you took P equals Q equals 2. So this corresponds to Cauchy-Schwarz. Now, if you want to split even a little bit more, you can do one thing. You can take here three halves, right, for example, and so you can take less for P and more for Q, or the other way around, right? So this is a trick that you might use, which might be really useful. Now, let me do a simple problem. Well, I would say it's simple, but anyways, let me erase it. And I'll show you how we can use the idea in solving another problem. Let me state both problems. The first problem says something like this. That is 1, this integral x times f of x dx is a, and the integral of x squared f of x dx is a squared. Second problem which was actually a Romanian national mathematical event in 1983 says something like it's fine all
you can start beats I'm going to continue.
Satisfying this. but it doesn't. But these problems are very correlated.
So I know a solution for problem one. How do I know if it's all the solutions? Like, I know a family of functions which satisfies that.
Really? Well, what is that family?
X e to the negative x over a.
I don't quite think so.
It's an exponential distribution. Oh, wait, this is for only from 0 to 1. Yeah,
yeah.
That's what we expect.
But the Richard stuff costs.
Well, there is a solution in the Berkeley book. They multiply this by A, they something by 2A, they try to make a square, whatever, something simple. But what if we use the previous idea? So let's see, problem one. So since we applied Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, why not do it again? So I have this piece of information that f is positive, which allows me to take the square root of f. So let's see, maybe I can do something here, right? The first remark would be that this guy times this guy is this guy squared. Right? So we observe that a squared. This is 1. And this is a squared, which are actually equal. But can we, you know what? In fact, I can prove that I have inequalities. That's what I'm going to prove. So we will show that in fact this times this is greater or equal than that. How are we going to do it? So let's rewrite it a bit. This guy is x root f of x squared dx times the integral from 0 to 1. This guy can write it as the square root of f squared. And again, by the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, this will be greater or equal than 1. And the integral this times this will be nothing else than x, f of x, dx, squared. Right? This guy is x squared f of x. This guy is f of x. What did we obtain? We obtained that a squared, so this is equivalent with a squared times 1 is greater or equal than a squared. Oh wow, so we have equality. So in fact, we have, when we have have equality in Koshish Schwartz inequality. When is this true?
What?
When? These are proportional, right? So x root f of x is lambda root f of x. The only option here we have is f of x to be 0. So the 0 function is the only function which will verify the conditions. But look, so there is no function. So there is no function f with satisfying those three conditions. Now let's see this guy here, because the idea is somehow similar. Does it make sense? Is it clear? See, the same technique over and over again. Let's do problem two, and then we're gonna stop for a short break, for a pizza break. Let me denote this by A. So what do I know? I know that I have a continuous function on 0, 1, which is non-negative, and very important information, which probably I need to explore, is that this is not increasing. So what do I know so far? I know that this integral of f of x dx is less than 1, and that the integral of f of x cubed dx is less than 3a squared. So I need to explore this somehow, because what is the thing that is bothering me in this? Is this argument here, x cubed. I don't want to deal with this. This is bothering me. So I want to get rid of it somehow. Maybe, you know, I want that guy to become an x. But what should I do here? The thing is that I need to explore that non-increasing thing. So let's see. What is x? Is it 0, 1? To compare x cubed will be less than x, right? And this is what comes, this is the trick. Where does the square root of x come here? It's here, or it's here? here, right? So it's less than. So I have this x cubed is less or equal than the square root of x. Rho x in 0, 1.
Looks like you mean cube root.
Oh, cube root, yes, sorry. I say something and I write something. But you understand what I'm saying. I was a little bit tired. And all these Putnam things come after I'm teaching like 5 or 6 hours. Now, I know that my function is not increasing. So if I apply f here, what can I say about f of x cubed? And f of cube root of x. That is what?
Greater than.
Greater or equal than. Now if I integrate, this implies that the integral 0 to 1 of f of x cubed dx is greater or equal than the integral from 0 to 1 of f of cube root of x dx. Now, I need to somehow make and what do I know about this?
Let's start with one. Let's start with 2, 3, whatever.
Yes. On the other hand, I know that this guy, let's keep in mind that this guy is less or equal than 3a squared, right? This guy here is less or equal than 3a squared. So therefore, this implies that suppose that the integral from 0 to 1 of f of cube root of x dx is less or equal than 3a squared. And now it looks like we need what? A change of variables. Right? Does it look like? So what change of variables should we use? The cube root of x is u. It follows that x is u cube, right? Dx is 3u squared du, and when x is 0, u is 0, when x is 1, u is 1, so therefore, this guy here will be equivalent to what? This will be equivalent to the integral from 0 to 1 of f of u times, and now let's see, dx is, so it's 3u squared du, which is less than 3a squared. Well, if we do the algebra, this would be equivalent with the integral from 0 to 1 of f of u, u squared f of u du less than 3a squared, or the integral. Well, this is just a dummy variable. I can say the integral x squared f of x dx is less or equal than a squared. Okay. So I have this information. This is less than 1. This is equal to a. And this is less than a squared. Does this ring a bell to you? Are we done now with this problem? Let me rewrite it again. So, I know that. Actually, let me do it here. So, I know that the integral to 1 of f of x dx is less than 1. I know that the integral from 0 to 1 of x f of x dx is a. And I know that the integral from 0 to 1 of x squared of f of x dx is less than a squared. Does this ring a bell to you? These three inequalities here?
Well, I know that with the second step, you can say that or a squared is less than or equal to integral of x squared f dx times integral of f.
Guys,
oh, and that's less than or equal to a.
Guys, it's the same thing as this whole.
Yeah.
Already solved. The only thing that this is less or equal than that, but I don't care. Because we use Cauchy-Schwarz.
Mm-hmm.
And when did we have equality? When f is 0. But in my problem, do they take zeros? Yes. So, follows from here, using problem 1, that f is 0. And that's it. This is the only function which satisfies these two conditions. So again, you have seen how simple problem, simple idea can solve this problem. Is it clear what I... Okay, let's take a break. F of 1 is 0. Then, actually this was a problem that I gave you as a homework, if I remember correctly. We have that f of c is the integral from 0 to c of f of x dx for some c. 0, 1. Second one, which was given at some Romanian national at the National Olympia in 2006, which says something a little bit like this. Again, I have a continuous function, real bad continuous function of 0, 1, such that the integral from 0 to 1 of f of x dx is 0. Then the integral from 0 to c of x times f of x dx is 0 for some c. Let's deal with the first problem. Okay, do we recognize something in the first problem? Is there a similar problem that we solve?
Yeah. The last one. A little bit similar.
I'm talking about this first problem.
Okay.
Didn't we solve something similar? I'm sure we did. And that similar problem was a little bit like this. So similar problem. How was that problem? It was that if I have a continuous real valued function of 0, 1 and the integral is 0, then the same conclusions holds true. What was the idea? Well, the idea is to construct a function which comes from solving the differential, the first order linear ODE, f prime equals f. The idea was to consider this function, I have t is e to the negative t times the integral from 0 to t of f to dx. And then we took into account that phi of 0 is phi of y equals 0, so by Rolle's theorem, the derivative has a 0. The derivative of this is e to the just computer. Well, the question is, can we use this same idea to produce a solution for this guy? The answer is yes. The thing is, how do I explore this condition? Well, let's mimic the same technique. So again, I consider that function. So phi of t is e to the negative t times the integral from 0 to t of f of x dx. Clearly, this is differentiable, no problem about it. The derivative, phi prime of t, is actually was negative e to the dx plus f of t dt. So, in other words, this would be e to the negative t times f of t minus the integral of t. Well, I cannot, well, I use the same idea, but not exactly the same solution, because I cannot apply Rolle's theorem. So the only information I have, if I take phi prime of 1, I'll have f of 1 here, which will be 0. So it will be the integral from 0 to 1, and I don't know anything about it. Right. But I can do something. What do I want to prove? Let's look at our conclusion. So the conclusion says that f of c equals this, the integral from 0 to c of f of x dx for some c. So let us assume by contradiction, that is not the case. assume by contradiction, well, without loss of generality, that f of t is greater than the integral from 0 to t of f of x dx. For all t in 0 to 1. Right? Let's assume this. And hopefully we'll reach a contradiction. Okay. If I have this assumption, what can I infer about my function? Phi. This guy will be how?
Positive.
Positive. So this is positive. This implies what? That implies what?
That's increasing.
Phi prime is greater than 0, so phi is increasing.
Strictly.
Well, increasing means strictly. Non-decreasing means?
Increasing to me means possibly constant.
Constant, okay, strictly. Okay. When I say increasing, I mean strictly increasing. And if I want to say increasing, also including the constant, I say non-decreasing.
Okay.
So this is increasing. What does this mean? This means that phi of 1 is greater than phi of 0. Let's look. Phi of 1 is what? Is 1 over 1 over e times the integral from 0 to 1 of f of x dx. Right? Phi of 0 is 0. This is greater than 0. So this implies that the integral from 0 to 1 of f of x dx is positive. So this is one piece of information.
That's a contradiction of what we just said about f of t.
What did we say?
We said f of t greater than integral from 0 to t fx dx for all t in 0, 1. So plus t equals 1.
Exactly. But let's look at our what we assumed here. That f of t is greater than the integral from 0 to t of f of x dx for all t in 0, 1. So therefore, in particular for f of 1, is strictly greater than the integral from 0 to 1 of f of x dx. Yeah, but this is 0. So this implies that this integral is negative. These two contradict each other. At one hand is positive, on the other hand is negative. So we can't. So this means that where the contradiction comes from? From our assumption that this holds true. Similarly, we're gonna have the same thing if this is less than this. We're gonna have the decreasing
one. You don't have to do the similar one because you can say the problem is invariant under change of sign or f. And so if it's unequal, it's either greater than or equal or less than.
Yes, exactly. That would be an idea. But you can say like we proceed similarly, it's the same idea. But yes, you should mention this.
On the Putnam, what should we do? Should we mention that the problem
is
invariant?
Always write as much as you can.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Within reason.
So don't say similarly, just either do it again or write as much as I can.
I would hedge one's bet and write it over again.
Okay. Actually, since you have the idea, it will take you only 5 minutes more.
Sure.
So,
you know, the whole game is not to give them an excuse to take any points.
Exactly. Because their grading is a mess. There is no secret about it. But anyway, I'm not complaining about their grading since we're on camera. You never know who might will watch this video at some point and that might be upset. Anyway. So as you can see, these two, the idea will... Now, let's look at this problem. This problem doesn't have any integrand factor, but perhaps will have a very similar reasoning to the first one. but somehow different setting. So let me do it. Bye-bye. So I have to prove that this is zero for something. Again, let's assume by contradiction. Rewrite this. So this guy so this is our assumption. Now the thing is that this guy here, I want to do an integration by parts, but this here is the derivative of the antiderivative prime, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's f big f prime of x, where this guy f of x is the integral from 0 to x of f of s ds, right? This is the antiderivative. And now let's do some integration by parts. So, integrating by parts. This would be what? X, capital F of x, from 0 to t, minus the integral from 0 to t of f of x dx, right? Which equals at 0, it will be 0, so it will be t f of t minus the integral from 0 to t of f of x dx. So I know that that t f of t is greater than the integral from 0 to t of f of x dx for all t. This is the information that we should have in mind. Now, what is the condition that we did not explore? Is this guy. How do I translate in terms of... So I know that the integral from 0 to 1 of f of x, dx is 0. This is, we can translate this. This is nothing else than f of 1 is 0. So therefore, if I take the limit here, so if I pass the limit as t approaches 1, right? And this, what do I get? I get f of 1, which is 0, is greater or equal than the integral from 0 to 1 of f of s here. So therefore, I can say, well, this will be equivalent to the integral from 0 to 1. F of x dx is less fixed than 0. Now, let's see, what can I do? Let's look at this condition, this inequality here. Let me define the following function. You will see, this is the surprise. So define h real value as h of t to be the following. F of t, no. So I want that to appear as a quotient. So I have this minus this, so it will be f of t over t for t different than 0 and 0 for t 0. Of course, this is differentiable, right? It's continuous, it's differentiable. Take the derivative, so h prime of t is, so here I'm going to have a t squared, there I'm going to have a, so f prime of t times t minus t prime times f of t, which is nothing else than t minus f of t. How is this? According, wait a second. We don't get exactly what we want. I want here to get something like the integral of that, because I want to make myself, I want to make this function increasing, so I want to use that inequality term, but it's not like that. So maybe I should do something else. I should modify this. You see, it doesn't work here. What am I supposed to do here? It doesn't work. So maybe this is not the right function I should define. Maybe I should change it. Maybe I should do something, should try something like the integral from 0 to t of f of x dx. Because I have it here, see? was not good to have little f of x. I should have the capital f of x. I have no problem with making this function, right? The way I define it is the continuous is differentiable, no problem with that. So now, let's rewrite it again. So we have t times the derivative of that, which will be t times f of t, big f of t, minus x t prime, which is 1, the integral from 0 to t of f of x dx, which is exactly what we want, over t squared. By what we have obtained there, this will be positive, so therefore h is increasing, strictly increasing. So therefore you can say that h of 1 is greater than h of 0. And now let's look. H of 0 is 0. H of 1 is what?
Integral from 0 to 1 of f of x.
Integral from 0 to 1 of big f of x, right?
Yes.
So this guy is strictly greater than 0. But look, this contradicts the fact that this is less. So this is a contradiction. We're done. Really nice. You see, somehow we did the same, similar idea to that problem, but well, we didn't have to deal with the integrand factor, right? But the same. Here you use integration by parts, but on one hand, after I took the limit, I got something positive, then doing something similar, I got something negative, just like I did previously in the previous problem. It's very similar reasoning. So this is actually a really, really beautiful problem. It has more of a meaning because this guy here is a kind of a Volterra operator. So if you define the Volterra map. Phi of f t, this will be phi of x, f of x dx. So in other words, you can even generalize this problem. This will be the so-called the kernel or the weight function. Let's call it the weight function. Weight. So the weight actually says that it's 0 at 0, 1 at 1, it's increasing, positive, then the Volterra map has 0 in 0, 1. And you can prove using similar reason. It has more depth to it than what it looks like. Now, I'm going to do one more problem, which I said I will do it from okay. I wanted to do way more, but unfortunately, the time is quite limited. So, last time, on Tuesday, we did of x times log 1 plus x over n plus x. Actually, we found the value, which was this 2 ln of 2 minus 1. Right? We did this last time, remember? And I told you to remember one small trick. So I'm not going to go into that, but I told you we're going to prove the general version of it, which says something like this. So this problem for monthly comes from another problem from some Romanian national Olympia. I think it's, I don't recall the year exactly, it's 2003. Which says something like, if we consider a function f defined on 0 infinity, real value, and g defined on 0, 1, closed bounded interval, real value. So these are two continuous functions. So continuous functions. Such that the limit as x approaches infinity of f of x is L. And by an L is a real number. They show that the limit as n approaches infinity of 1 over n, the integral from 0 to n of f of x f g of x over n dx is L times the integral from 0 to 1 of g of x dx. Can you tell me how we solve this problem based on this? Well, first problem follows from the second problem by just taking what functions? F of x is what?
X over 1 plus x.
X over 1 plus x. And g of x is?
Log of 1 plus x.
Log of 1 plus x. Well, let's see. If we apply the second problem, what are we going to get? Let's see. The limit as x approaches infinity of f of x is what? Is 1. And the integral from 0 to 1 of g of x, dx, is what? Is 2 ln of 2 minus 1. After you do some iteration methods, so it all seems good. When we solved the first problem, we did something. We did a change of variables, right? X over n equals u. And at some point in the solution, we got something like, actually, you don't need to do the change of variables first. There is something about this x here, x and 1 plus x. And that something was to add and subtract 1. Remember the idea? Well, here it's a little bit more general, and perhaps it looks a little bit more complicated at first, but we're going to do exactly the same thing. So let's look at our integral. So the integral from 0 to n of f of x times g of x over n dx. And also 1 over n. I know that the limit, let's not forget about this information. It might be helpful. So I want to do something to mimic something similar. I want to add, that's the trick. I want to add and subtract L. So this would be equal to 1 over n, the integral from 0 to n of f of x minus L plus L times g of x over n. So let's do some algebra here. So this would be 1 over n, the integral from 0 to n of f of x minus l times g of x over n dx plus 1 over n, the integral from 0 to n of of what? L times g of x over n dx, right? This guy, let me take care of this guy first. If we do the change of variables x over n equals u, so this means that dx is n du, when x equals 0, u is 0, when x equals n, u is 1. So therefore, this guy here will be, well, nothing else than L times the integral from 0 to 1 of g of u du. Agree with me? So, and I need to prove that the limit of this is actually that. So if I show that this goes to 0 as n approaches infinity, if I'm showing this, I'm done. Right? Because the limit of this is this. So the only thing that I'm left to do is to show this. So let's, so we need to show the limit as n approaches infinity of 1 over n times the
isn't that like a two line?
How?
Well, they're both continuous functions. The limit of f is it has a finite limit. It doesn't go off to infinity at infinity. It's only defined from 0. So each one is bounded because they're both bounded. That whole integral. But
so wait a second. Not both of them are bounded. How do you know?
You know, f, I know f and g are bounded.
G is bounded.
Yeah.
That's a yes, because it's defined on a compact interval. This is not defined. It's like,
but it's still bounded.
It's still bounded. Yes.
But that doesn't count much because you just get some constant.
Exactly. So. But this will be an information for you to look at. That was, actually, this is my question. Who is bothering you here? G. Because I have x over n here. I don't know how to control this. But I can get rid of it because I know that g is bounded. Why? My Weierstrass theorem is continuous on 0, 1, so it's bounded. So I can get rid of it. So I'll have something like this. So I have, let me take the absolute value. Well, if I take the absolute values, this will be less than m, so okay, let me put it like this. This will be 0, greater equal than 0, less or equal than, let's say this is m over n times the m, let me put it like this, times the f of x minus m. And now guess what? I need to compute somehow. If I show that the limit of this is 0, I'm done. Right? So we show that the But we need to justify this really, really carefully. It's obvious, but so let me rewrite this guy as the integral from 0 to n of f of x minus l dx over f. Well, I have two sequences. You can consider this like a sequence an. And this is like a sequence bn. And you know, we did something long some time ago, which is called a discrete version of the L'Hopital rule. Chesaro-Stoltz, exactly. So by the Chesaro-Stoltz lemma, so this will be equal to, here is Chesaro-Stoltz lemma. This will be equal to, this guy will be n plus 1. This will be the integral from 0 to n plus 1 of this minus the integral from 0 to n, which will be, in other words, the integral from n to n plus 1 after you do the operations of f of x minus l dx over n plus 1 minus n, which is 1, right? And now, by the mean value theorem for integrals, what do we get? This will be n plus 1 minus n, which is 1, f of cn minus L for some Cn between n and n plus 1. Yeah, but as n approaches infinity, this is actually 0. So as we take as n approaches infinity, f of Cn will approach goes to L. Of course, Cn approaches infinity, so we're done. So, in other words, indeed, this is the limit of this is 0. And going back, this converges to 0. So, by the squeeze theorem, this will do. That's really, really beautiful problem. So yeah, it's more, certainly a bit more difficult than the particular case. Well, I had way more problems to do, but that's fine.